Hello, and welcome back to A Better World. This is your host, Mitchell J. Raven, and we're very glad you're joining us again today. Today we're going to have another very interesting show. We're very glad to have with us the authors of this book, Peter and Monica Ressler, who wrote a book called Spiritual Capitalism. This book goes into one of our favorite subjects, which is how to spiritualize our society all around, i.e. bringing ethics to the table, bringing ethics into corporate America and a larger view of what can be possible through business by being humane. They have been in the business world, both of them, with their own headhunting company, working with Fortune 500 companies for many, many years. They know business from the inside out. And so the work they're doing now, which is spiritualizing business from the inside out, is of real notable value. So we're very glad to have you both on the show with us.
Thank you. We'd love to be here. Thank you.
Absolutely.
We're honored to be here, Mitch.
So glad you're here. Good. So tell me, what for you both does spiritual capitalism mean?
You have your mic?
Spiritual capitalism, I guess the best way to define that would be to understand that everything that we do in business is done by other human beings. Business is really a mechanism to provide a product or a service to somehow enhance the life of another human being. And that product and that service is provided by a human being, created by a human being. And so the spiritual aspect of business is really the humane aspect of business. When we're told it's not personal, it's business, when we separate ourselves and think incorrectly that the only reason we're in business, whether we own one or work in one or work for one, is to profit for ourselves alone, we're missing the entire point. As soon as you remove the service aspect from your product and or whatever the services that you provide, your business will cease to exist. And so the underlying humanity...
In the long run.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And sometimes in the short run.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, people aren't going to buy a product that doesn't make their life better. A product that doesn't serve some purpose for their lives.
Sure.
And so...
Sure, it has to have that level of market savvy. But what you're saying is actually going beyond that. It's not just the product itself being of value, but the way it's delivered, the people who are delivering it, the personal relationships between the business itself and its customer base. Is that what I kind of hear you saying?
It's all connected.
It's all connected, yeah.
You know, we're all, you know, each and every one of us is, in fact, a human being. And so in our pursuit of profit, we have a unique opportunity to provide a service to someone else. And we believe that it just simply requires a shift in the way we think about our pursuit of profit and the way we think about of how we make our money.
Peter, you're saying that to humanize that process is to be fulfilling this idea of a spiritual capitalism. To humanize that?
What we call spiritual, and that's always an interesting question because everyone has a different spiritual concept.
Sure.
There's one universal spiritual concept, and that is shared humanity, that sacredness of
Let's
life.
Bring that up to your mouth.
Oh, okay. Sacredness of life, not just human life, all life. So that brings capitalism into, if you respect and honor the sacred in all life, that's also the environment, that's other human beings. It would encompass everything from who you hire to who you sell to, who your products are aimed for, what kind of product it is, what value it has in the universe, in the world at large, and how we apply that to the natural world. How does that affect the natural world? So really, spiritual capitalism is just including in the pursuit of profit a shared humanity, a sense of honoring other people's lives. Basically, namaste, you know, the divine in
yes.
you and the divine in me.
Yes.
And seeing that part in our pursuit of money. They're not separate.
Absolutely. So Peter before made reference to this idea, well, that's business,
right.
Which is a kind of a common idiom in our society,
mm-hmm.
which has the ability to separate out my own personal ethics from the way I make money. Almost like anything goes when it comes to making money. So it's sort of like you can go to church on Sunday or shul on Saturday, mm-hmm. as the case may be, right. And then on Monday, no holds barred. You can do anything to anyone, anytime, anywhere, as long as it's going to make you more.
Actually, that's true, and I think that we've been raised that way. I think when you go to business school, you're told that, you know, make money, profit is the bottom line. That's the only bottom line. Well, what we find is, and what we found personally in our lives,
so untrue.
It is untrue because it's not even logical. I mean, it defies logic. We had a friend who was wonderful, and he ran a Midtown search firm. He had a clientele that he had worked with for years. He was an extraordinary man personally, a devoted father, a devoted husband. Yet in his business, his whole attitude was every time he saw a client, he saw dollar signs. And so he created a reputation for himself. He's still in business now, but he created a reputation for himself that whatever he could do to make the money was what he was going to do. He'd lie to them, talk to them, and tell them anything they wanted to hear with the whole attitude that it was short-term profit. Mm. So when business slowed down, especially after 9/11, he was almost out of business because he didn't have the sense of loyalty and trust that other people had created with that longer-term approach. And it was a really good man, and I think we started thinking about it then. We started thinking about how separate he was, what an honorable person he was personally, what a good friend he was, as a matter of fact, and how he had this separation in his own mind that money and anything in the pursuit of money was okay.
Yeah. No, I understand. I think it's a very good point, and it's scary what that division has been.
Right.
And I feel that through your work,
right,
and the work of others and what we do here on A Better World are seeking to heal that very peculiar and illogical and non-business savvy rift.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's interesting. I mean, you treat your wife in a certain way, you treat your kids in a certain way, you know, there's a certain level of honesty or complete honesty that you should have in most of your personal relationships, and yet there is that incredible disconnect between our pursuit of profit, and we don't think the bridge is all that far to build. We don't think it's the construction's going to take that off mm-hmm. that very very long because, mm-hmm. you know, as Monica put it, you know, it's just logic. I mean, if you want to stay in mm-hmm. business for the long term, when things get tough, and you treat your employees really well, they'll back you up. You know, we saw that in the fire department. When I became a fireman after September 11th,
mm-hmm. That's extraordinary that you did
it
that.
It
really
yeah.
is.
I
understand the impulse because they were so exemplary in their behavior.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, I walked into a world that I had never seen before. I mean, these guys backed each other up. The first thing they said in fire school was, you never leave without your brother. You never turn your back on your brother. And I'm sitting there and you know, I'm living in Wall Street, you know, which is like, hey, look, if you got to kill your brother for $500,000,
exactly,
just don't get caught, you'll be okay.
Right, right.
You know, it's the right thing to do.
Yeah, actually,
you know,
like,
these guys are like
your brother. You know?
Yeah,
that's
no, exactly. Yeah. I mean, it was the opposite.
Michael Douglas, the firm. It's a,
yeah. What I saw in training, the way the brotherhood, the unity, and unity there's strength,
yeah.
I thought to myself, my God, this is if we could take this template and put it, you know, slip it out and put it into the business template, because when you think about the companies
exactly.
that have that kind of loyalty, like for example, I just mentioned one.
Please.
Southwest Airlines did not lay one person off after 9/11. In an industry that was absolutely devastated. Why? Because they understand that you want to treat your workers with respect, with dignity. You want to pay them well. You want to pay them fairly. They were important. Just like every fireman is important to another fireman, every employee and every customer was important to those people at Southwest. And so they had a fund set aside whereby if something extraordinary happened, nobody gets laid off. In unity, there's strength.
Actually, the CEO said that Herb Kelleher said that it wasn't even an option. It wasn't even an option to lay off one person. It was a given that they would keep everybody. And I think that that is one of the most profound examples of spiritual capitalism, because they understood that their employees, their whole workforce, were more than just workers. It's unusual because in a Fortune 500 company, of which they are, the first thing you do is you slice off, you know, as many people as you can. Okay, what can we do without? And remarkably, what people don't realize in the business world is that when you see these devastating cuts and job losses, and it affects individual lives, and you know you have to rebuild. I mean, job losses are part of business, so sometimes you have to lay people off. We also did after 9/11. We did about a year later. We had to lay people off, but we had such loyalty to them that we made sure they had other jobs. We made sure we gave them severance. But we're a small business. When you get to be a larger business, a Fortune 500 company, you don't see your employees. So it's very easy to just cut off 10,000 jobs.
Numbers on a page.
Right. But it's very interesting because the opposite of Herb Kelleher at Southwest was, for example, Ford Motor Company just laid off, I think it's 30,000 people. And we also read in the newspaper very recently that the new CEO, in 3 months of work, got paid $28 million. So interestingly enough, that's about an average of $100 million a year, and they just laid off 30,000 people. It might have been 20, as a matter of fact. But if you think about those 20,000 employees, how many of them could you have kept if you actually made maybe $8 million? You know, he might be able to survive on that for 3 months. And just the attitude, and I don't mean there's anything wrong with money, but at what expense?
Oh, exactly.
20,000 people that are devastated and destroyed in an area where it's very, very, very difficult to get work, and where those people are basically, you know, they're lower middle class. This is $16 an hour they were making, and this person is making $28 million. I think what we're trying to do is not say that it's wrong, not judge him, but try to inspire people to do the right thing, to do what Herb Kelleher did, say it's not an option to do that, that I would feel ashamed of myself to take $28 million for 3 months of work at the expense of 20,000 people's jobs.
Well, you should be glad that you don't have to be inside him to sleep at night.
Yeah, I don't want to talk about him as a bad person, because I think that we need to get away from judgment and try to encourage and inspire people to be their best selves.
Agreed.
He's just doing what he learned in business school. I'd like business schools to start taking action and change the...
That he is actually a function. I'm not saying he's a bad person. That's
right.
What I'm saying. But I would say there's a level of unconsciousness that he is indulging.
Yes.
I would say that.
But
for anyone who has reached the level of CEO, for him not to see the intense disparity, you know, one would have to actually be blind. And so what I think that you two are helping to bring to the foreground is this idea of equity,
mm-hmm.
and how, let me put it this way, enlightened self-interest.
Absolutely.
Why don't we put it that way?
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think a good example of that also is Google. Google's phenomenal to us. I mean, we know people that work there. We also understand that they take, I think, no salary or a dollar a year, and they put it back in the company. Okay, they're extremely profitable. And let's see what they do when the times get rough.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they show a good role model. They're very, it has an enlightened pursuit of profit,
mm-hmm.
that they make sure that everybody that's involved profits, including their customers. I mean, they have an honorable sense of how to advertise, too. You know, they have a certain, when they did their IPO, they had a very strict moral code when they did that. They said, we're in it for the long term, not the short term. And I mean, they've gone from an opening of $90 a share to $500 a share. So obviously, their model of capitalism works. And I think they present an example for all of Wall Street.
One of the things that came up in Patricia Aberdeen's book, Megatrends 2010, which we had spoken of a little bit before, is she showed how many mutual funds these days that are green-based,
mm-hmm.
Or socially conscious-based are doing exceedingly well.
Right,
As a trend.
Yes.
What were you going to say, Peter?
It's really a fairly simple process to raise someone's awareness about how their actions affect other people's lives. I think most of the guys that are running and girls that are running, you know, the big companies are good people. And, you know, they're taught there's a focus, there's a shareholder, there's a target, and we need to hit those targets no matter what. And what we're saying in spiritual capitalism is, as you're hitting that target, just take a minute and think about the outcome of your bullseye, right? If you had a sister or a brother that just lost their job and is now concerned about how they're going to keep their kids in school and put food on the table, would you be so so singly laser right. focused on this? Or would you find, and you know what, at the end of the day, Mitch, there may be no other way, okay? You may just have to do the cutting. But if you're going to do the cutting, there's the right way to do it and a wrong way to do it. And the first thing, in our view, is do I have another option? All right? Instead of laying these people off, where else can I cut costs? Where else can I find the funds? How else can I, even if it means, you know, maybe I take a reduced salary? Well, there's a lot of ways, okay? Yes, but yes, once all those have been exhausted, then, you know, we know businesses where if a manager has to lay an employee off, they do it face to face. They do it over lunch. Mm-hmm. They mm-hmm. then have, they invite that employee that's been laid off a month later to another lunch to see how they're doing. They treat them like human beings.
Actually, that's Robert Wimette.
Hey, beautiful.
Yeah, there's.
That's what we need to be treat each other and be treated like human beings.
If, right. if you're going to have
is
to lose
asking
your job,
so much?
Do it humanely.
Absolutely. Also, it is on one-on-one. We think of business as being corrupt, as business being greedy. And I like to point out that greed has no social or economic boundaries. It goes through all layers of society. For example, if you take your car in to get fixed, and the mechanic tells you you need three things that you really don't need, I mean, that's a basis of greed. And they might be making, you know, $40 an hour and not the CEO of a Fortune 500 company, but still, it's the same level. So we want to point out that there's...
Well, it's the same, let's say, pathology.
Same pathology.
And it is a pathology.
Absolutely. So it's not just about business. We had a letter from one of our... we had done a workshop, and this one particular woman sent us a letter, and she said she had been afraid to talk during the workshop, but she wanted to let us know that we had ridden her of her last bastion of prejudice, and that was that money was corrupt and business was corrupt. Because what's happened in business is that there's so many good people in business, believe me, on Wall Street as well. We know so many. But there's a taboo to be conscious, a taboo to be honorable. It's thought to make you vulnerable. So we like to use a whole different concept.
It's a machismo attitude.
Yes, absolutely.
Can I tell my Elliot Spitzer story?
Oh, yeah.
Please.
Watching Bill Moyers one night, and the show was on Elliot Spitzer, and they were interviewing Jim Cramer. And so I don't think it was Moyers, I think it was his right-hand anchor, said to him, "Well, Jim, you know, what are the guys on the streets saying about Spitzer?" And he said, "Well, you know, if you're in a bar and you're talking to a group of them, they think that he's the Antichrist. But if you take each one of those guys individually, each one of them will say he's doing the right thing." Mm. So, and I almost fell off my chair when I heard that, because it's true. You know, people need permission to do the right thing. People really want to do the right thing. And, you know, if enough of us can bring that up to the fore, you know, and I think, I don't want to push my book, but what the heck, I'll push it anyway.
Hey, you can. Please.
If you read that...
That's the whole point. We want people to read this and get educated.
If you read that book, you'll never think about your work the same way. I don't care if you're a CEO of a Fortune 500 company or the guy that, you know, drives the sanitation trucks around the city. It's a whole different way of thinking. And every major change that has ever taken place in this country and in this world starts with a thought.
Right.
Exactly. And a good thought, hopefully. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I agree. I think that we're ultimately really dealing with is just human nature.
Yes.
Business is just another vehicle, like sciences, like the arts are. It's just another vehicle for human beings to actually hang out with each other and have a lot of fun while making hay, so to speak. It's all good. It's just that when things get out of
balance that we have trouble. And I mean, that's just my way of saying. I mean, I think it's pretty obvious. Joseph Campbell, who's been one of my mentors over the years, tells a story about two people standing on a street corner and the light changes and one doesn't see, and the other one, to a total stranger, grabs them, puts their own life in jeopardy and grabs the other one to save his or her life. Like that. What is that human impulse about?
Well, you know
but
what?
It's because we are one. We feel and know it on some very deep, beautiful level, and we act that way when we're in accordance with it.
Well, I have to tell you, we saw that on 9/11.
Yeah.
You know, we saw investment bankers pulling plumbers out of the rubble. Yeah. I had firemen friends of mine that told me, you know, I could not believe how many civilians were not running out the building and were helping people who were pregnant, who were infirm, who were old. That is who we are at our core. And when we saw that on 9/11, one of the reasons we wrote the book was we thought to each other, we said to each other, God, you know, that's who we are at our core. Why does it have to take a tragedy like 9/11 to bring out the best in every one of us?
Good point, Peter. Really. Exactly. It doesn't.
It doesn't.
You've already answered your question.
I actually think that tragedies reveal who we really are, and I find them a great teaching tool, a great spiritual tool, as a matter of fact.
Surely.
Because in tragedy, if we take 9/11, for example, we had a small group of people that wanted to destroy innocent life that, you know, never directly affected them and felt justified in doing that. And that's a universal human. It's not just one particular group. It's everyone. And then we had a very large group of people, the majority of New Yorkers, the majority of the country, the majority of the modern world, that felt quite different, the opposite in fact, that felt the suffering with those who were suffering, that felt this loss deeply. I remember we saw pictures of people looking up at the towers and they were crying and they were devastated. You could see the agony on their faces, and they didn't even know the people in the buildings that this was happening to, because at the core of every one of us is something greater than we even can imagine. And I feel that that's the root of who we all are. That's the divinity within ourselves. The part of us that is of love for other people, that is more than anything else, more than hatred, more than destruction, that's who we are. When you look at a baby, for example, you don't see hatred. They're not capable of hate, because that's how we all start. When we come into this world, that's who we are. We're of love, not hate. And so I'd like to just mention that we get very cynical and we go on these talks around the country and we try to inspire people to see that human beings are in fact greater than what we really believe they are when we're watching the news or reading the newspaper, that we're really of something extraordinary.
So I agree with you. And at the same time, look at what's being marketed. Tragedy is being marketed by the newsrooms. Why is this? Why is this? Why if... There's not an if, actually, about what we are at core for me.
Yes, exactly.
And there is this entire syndrome, you could say, societal syndrome, that just is indulging this weaker, much less honorable part of ourselves that actually, on some weird level, enjoys witnessing tragedy.
Absolutely.
There's
this
dichotomy, this paradox in our human nature.
Well, look, I think you have to look back at how this country started and where we were 50 years ago, 100 years ago, 150 years ago. It's about really a slow process of enlightenment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was never a woman in the CEO position 25 years ago. There was never, you know, children were being forced to work at the age of 9, 10 years old. All of the, you know, the place where we are today, you know, was very different than it was as short as 50 years ago. And so we're moving closer and closer to a higher level of enlightenment.
Definitely.
And as the media, as
and
we just witnessed, as we just witnessed with IMUS, you know, and the, I mean, 10 years ago, nobody would have even given it, 5 years ago, nobody would have even said a word about
here in 30 seconds,
what he said.
He's fired in a week.
Okay, so I have hope.
Yeah, me too.
I think we're moving in the right direction.
Me too. You know, I guess, Peter, I'm reacting to the old notion that man plans and God laughs. You know, there's a timetable at play here that none of us really quite know all the details of, and we're turning it out as best we can and making our contribution as best we can to uplifting
the evolution and enlightenment of our society.
And I think it's happening. I really, really feel everywhere I go, the radio stations, television stations, books, magazines. I mean, every month there's a new magazine out or a new radio station on the air that talks about what's positive. I think this paradigm is shifting. I absolutely do, and that's why we're out there talking about it.
Exactly. Well, your book goes into some detail about how the world is shifting.
Absolutely.
And I feel that you are helping really to inspire many to move in that direction, you know, to view business as a vehicle for doing good. You know, 60 Minutes, one of my favorite commercial programs, did an amazing segment some time ago about a privately held high-tech corporation. I think it was in North Carolina. They had not only daycare centers, they had
SAS.
They had almost a hospital. They
had
golf courses.
It's in our book, right.
Oh, it is? Really? And it was so beautiful. And they were asked, employees were asked, would you consider working anywhere else? They said, why? We're happy.
Right.
We're in the right place.
Right.
This is it. What we're going to say.
No, I think that that's in our book, and that gives us hope for the future.
Doesn't it? It's that, and they're hugely successful.
Right.
They're hugely successful.
They are.
Wow. I want to just thank you both for being on the show.
Well, really thank you. We loved it. Loved it. Loved it.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thanks for the work that you're doing. It's wonderful.
Thank you very much. Thanks. So let us all continue together.
Okay.
Okay. This is Mitchell J. Raven for A Better World. We've been speaking with Monica and Peter Ressler, the authors of this wonderful book, Spiritual Capitalism. Take the time, read it, and get back to us about it. Thanks so much for joining us, and look forward to seeing you all next week.